Welcome to Online Worship with Hyde Park United Methodist Church. I'm Matt Hotho, the Director of Worship Technology.
And I'm Emily Felgenhauer, the Director of Youth Ministries. Thanks for joining us today. Our mission is to make God's love real, teaching people to follow Jesus by loving God and loving all. Take a moment to register your attendance and submit any prayer requests via the link in the video description or in the chat window. One of our spiritual practices is to pray with confidence and conviction, believing that our prayers really make a difference.
Next week is Communion Sunday. Communion will be offered at our in-person 9:30 a.m. service, as well as online immediately following our service in the Zoom discussion room. Bookmark the link below so that you don't miss it. Next week will also be the last week we do our post-service Zoom discussion group until the fall. I've enjoyed meeting many of you, and I cannot wait to meet more of you in the fall.
Today is a bittersweet day for me. It's my last Sunday here at Hyde Park as the Director of Youth Ministries. It's been such a blessing to be here for the last 11 years. You guys have welcomed me. You have been with me in prayer. You've worked with me in the youth ministry. It's been incredible. I can't tell you how many amazing memories I'm taking with me from Hyde Park. I'm headed to First Lakeland United Methodist as their Director of Youth Ministries, and I'm really looking forward to being a part of that congregation. But no, I will really miss you guys too.
And Emily, it's bittersweet for me too. You were one of the first people I met on staff. You came here, welcomed me in when I was just fresh out of seminary. So thanks for being a part of the team, and you're going to be missed.
Thank you.
Yeah. Today, we are also continuing our series, Comeback, Faith to Move Forward. Our senior pastor, McGray de Vega, will be preaching about Peter, a first century Jewish Christian who followed Jesus but didn't quite always get it right. And maybe you can relate with following Jesus and not always getting it right, or maybe you know somebody who can relate to that story. Maybe you should invite them to join us in worship. Welcome to worship.
As we prepare for prayer today, we center ourselves in the story of Peter, who experiences the grace of God amid his flaws and his mistakes. I invite you during this prayer time to do a self-examination of the areas of your life that require God's forgiveness, knowing that all of us, without exception, are in need of God's grace. You might choose to share your confession in the form of this question: God, I want to be better at blank. How would you answer that question in your spirit? So type your response in the chat section and join in praying for one another as we go to God in prayer.
Let us pray to our kind and merciful God that his love for us may animate all we do and that our love may become contagious. That the church, the people of God, may never cease to proclaim by its teaching, life, and worship. That love of God and neighbor is the heart of the gospel, and that people are God's gifts to us. Let us pray. Help us to feed your lambs, that people may not lose their hearts in today's economic systems of profit, efficiency, production, and competition, but that they may keep giving first place to human relationships of friendship and respect. Let us pray. Help us to take care of your sheep, that we may have room in our hearts and homes for refugees and strangers, that we may learn to share our goods and ourselves with the little people loved by God. The poor and the lonely and those who suffer, let us pray. Help us to feed your sheep, that in our Christian communities, we may uplift one another rather than tear down, accept each other with trust and affection. Forgive one another from the heart and go forward together in hope and love. Let us pray. Help us to follow you. These things we ask in the name of Jesus, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. And thy the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Listen for the word of God from the Gospel of John, chapter 21, verses 15 through 19. This reading comes from the Common English Bible. When they finished eating, Jesus asked Simon Peter, Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these? Simon replied, Yes, Lord, you know I love you. Jesus said to him, Feed my lambs. Jesus asked a second time, Simon, son of John, do you love me? Simon replied, Yes, Lord, you know I love you. Jesus said to him, Take care of my sheep. He asked a third time, Simon, son of John, do you love me? Peter was sad that Jesus asked him a third time, Do you love me? He replied, Lord, you know everything. You know I love you. Jesus said to him, Feed my sheep. I assure you that when you were younger, you tied your own belt and walked around wherever you wanted. When you grow old, you will stretch out your hands and another will tie your belt and lead you where you don't want to go. He said this to show the kind of death by which Peter would glorify God. After saying this, Jesus said to Peter, Follow me. The word of God for the world. Thanks be to God.
Our comeback worship series concludes today with one of the greatest comeback figures in the Gospels, and second only to Paul, the least likely person in the New Testament you would expect to become a biblical hero. The story of Peter is littered with more evidence of his flaws than of his faithfulness. He was hot-headed and reckless and weak in faith. At one point, Jesus even took one look at him eye to eye and told him to get behind me, Satan. Not exactly the stuff of Christian legend. But the Bible points out these flaws not to show us how bad Peter was, but to show us how powerful God's grace is. And by the end of this story, we can discover that if God can use someone like Peter to be the very foundation of the church itself, then God can use us too. In John's Gospel, the first thing we learn about Peter is his name. He was born Simon ben Jonah, or son of Jonah. His birth name, Simon, was derived from the Hebrew word shema, meaning to hear. It's one of the most important words in the Old Testament. But in the decades leading up to the time of Jesus, that popular name Simon became associated with the Jewish rebels who sought to overthrow the oppressive regime of the Seleucid dynasty. I mean, the leader of the rebellion was Simon Maccabeus. Now, while we can't know for sure whether old man Jonah decided to name his boy Simon after that great rebel leader, we can imagine what his name must have evoked for everyone who heard his name. And true to his name, Simon was every bit the rebel. Rash, riled up, and ready to overthrow Rome. Well, in John chapter 1, Simon's brother Andrew met Jesus, and he was so overtaken with excitement that he went to his brother Simon and said, "We have met the Messiah. Come and see." So Simon followed him. Andrew introduced him to Jesus, and then the unusual happened. Jesus and Simon looked at each other, eye to eye, and Jesus said something astonishing. "You are no longer Simon. Your name is Cephas." In Greek, the word was Petra, or Peter, which means rock. Simon the rebel became Peter the rock. Now, we're not told what Peter's reaction was, but we can imagine how hard that was for him and his friends to believe. A rock, Jesus? Really? A rock is steady, stable, reliable. Jesus, are you sure you got the right guy? You're going to build an institution on the most anti-institutional guy around? You're going to create a foundation with someone who is about as shaky and unsteady as they come? Yep. That's exactly what Jesus did, and here's why. God sees us, not just for who we are, but for who we can become. Somewhere beneath that imperfect, mistake-prone persona, God saw a saint. God saw a comeback story, just like God sees in you. Michelangelo was once asked how he was able to sculpt such marvelous masterpieces out of such raw and unfinished stone. His answer was simple. He said he saw the finished masterpiece inside the stone and gradually removed anything on the surface that didn't belong. God sees you for who you can become. Mount Rushmore is one of the great national treasures of our country. The images of Washington, Jefferson, Roosevelt, and Lincoln have endured for 80 years since sculptor Gutzon Borglum completed it in 1941. But what you may not know is that Rushmore is not yet finished. Borglum said these words, quote, "I am allowing an extra 3 inches on all the features of the various presidents in order to provide stone for the wear and tear of the elements, which cuts the granite down 1 inch every 100,000 years. 3 inches, he said, would require 300,000 years to bring the work down to the point where I would like to finish it. In other words, the work will not be done for another 300,000 years as it should be." Just like Mount Rushmore, Jesus saw in Peter an unfinished work that over time could be carved into a masterpiece. Peter didn't see it and would spend the next 3.5 years with Jesus proving just how he was much more like Simon the rebel than Peter the rock. But Jesus saw him for what he could become and never gave up on him. None of us like to admit our flaws and our imperfections in public. But we all know in private we are very hard on ourselves, and we know just how much we are like Simon Peter. We may not have ever walked on water, but we sure know what it's like to sink and feel like we are much too weak in our faith. We may not have ever cut off someone's ear like Peter did, but we sure know what it feels like to lose control of our emotions, to snap at someone in anger, and to feel consumed by revenge. We may not have ever denied our faith in Jesus three times in a courtyard at night, but we've all heard the rooster crow, pointing out when we have not put God first, when it mattered the most. But even through it all, God still sees you for who you can become and is relentless at helping you get there. You know what? In Methodist terms, we call this going on to perfection. In fact, the concept of going on to perfection is an important hallmark to being United Methodist. In 1790, John Wesley wrote a letter to a friend named Robert Carr Brackenbury. Wesley, at that point, was elderly and tired and approaching the end of his life. And as he looked back on everything his Methodist movement had experienced and achieved, he felt like there was one reason alone, why God had created the Methodist movement to begin with. It was the doctrine of Christian perfection, he said. The belief that God sees us for what we can become and will never stop working to make us more and more like Jesus. So in that letter to Mr. Brackenbury, Wesley wrote these words: "I am glad that our mutual friend has more light with regard to full sanctification. This is the grand doctrine which God has lodged with the people called Methodist, and it is chiefly for the sake of teaching this doctrine that God has raised us up." In other words, Wesley believed until the day he died that the reason Methodists were on earth was to preach that God is making us perfect. Of all that we believe as United Methodist Christians, the most important, the most distinctive part of our faith is that God sees us for who we can become and is relentless in helping us get there. You know, it's why he insisted that every Methodist who wants to become a pastor be asked three questions, the very questions that I and every other Methodist clergy had to answer when we were ordained. Number one, are you going on to perfection? Number two, do you expect to be made perfect in love in this life? And number three, are you earnestly striving after it? Now, notice in the way that question is worded, Christian perfection does not mean that we will become flawless or sinless or morally faultless. It is about God making us more perfect in love, such that every day we can make the conscious effort to love God more than we did yesterday and to love others more than we did before. And that's why, at the end of John's gospel, in today's scripture reading, after Peter had denied Jesus three times, Jesus asks him three times this very question: Peter, do you love me? And three times Jesus followed up with the words, then feed my sheep and feed my lambs. In other words, Peter, love others. For Jesus, the choice to love God and to love others is the only thing that matters. And learning to grow in that capacity to love is a lifelong process that will be perfected in this life. So here's the thing. Now, if we look back at the life of Peter, we can now see evidence of God at work. When Peter tried to walk on water and he began to sink, we might see it as failure, but Jesus used it as an opportunity to teach Peter how to have a strong faith. When Peter committed an act of violence against that Roman soldier, Jesus used it as an opportunity to teach Peter the way of peace. And when Peter denied Jesus three times, Jesus made sure that the last thing he heard in his soul was not the crow of a rooster, but the voice of forgiveness from Jesus. Jesus never gave up on Peter. And God sees you for who you can become and will be relentless in helping you get there. By the way, if you've been keeping count, I've said that phrase seven times in today's sermon. Communications experts tell us that it takes hearing a message seven times before it starts to sink in. The good news is that God tells us this message every single moment, moving us toward perfection and love. And all you have to do is hear it and respond. How about at the start of each day, you look yourself in the mirror and say, God, I know how messed up my life is. I am not perfect. I have my flaws and my insecurities, and I try to compensate for them by proving to others how flawless I want them to think I am, but I'm not good at pretending, and I am tired. So thank you, God, for seeing me more for what I can become. Show me today to do the only thing that matters. Show me to love you more with everything I got. And show me how to love other people, to feed your lambs and tend your sheep, and to love all people with everything I have. I believe, God, that you are moving me toward perfection in love, and I will do my best to be a person of love today. Let us pray. God, we are unfinished works, covered with flaws, concealing your deep image within us. Yet we can see now in retrospect the evidence of how you have been relentlessly at work to show us the better way, the way of love. May we hear your Spirit prod us with the question of whether we love you and love others, and may answering yes be our number one goal each and every day. For amid the chaos of daily living, it is the only thing we can control and the only thing that matters. Thank you for seeing in us what we can become. In Jesus' name, amen. Loving God and loving all is at the heart of our mission to make God's love real. You make that happen whenever you offer yourself to God through the ministries of this church. Your generosity helps people become more perfect in love, just like Mindy Vaughn, who is the operations manager at the Portico Cafe. Let's hear her story.
Working at the Portico has aided my recovery by giving me a stable environment. When you support the church, when you support the cafe, you're changing someone's life. This gave me an opportunity to work somewhere that was safe, that was supportive, that was encouraging. It laid the foundation for my future. Hi, I'm Mindy Vaughn. I'm the operations manager at the Portico Cafe. The easy answer to what led to my addiction is I was born an addict. My father was an addict, and I grew up with him in and out of prison. I started using drugs like smoking pot and drinking in high school. And then, of course, as I got older, that progressed. So it got to the point where I was living in a tent in the woods, like panhandling for money. I lost family, I lost friends. At the height of my addiction, I got pregnant. Unfortunately, that wasn't enough to stop me from using. And at that point, DCF was called. They put me in treatment at DACO, and that was when the Portico Cafe was being built and they were starting the process of opening the doors. So while I was at DACO at the very end of my treatment stay, they called and they said, hey, we need a couple people to interview down here, send a couple people. And I was one of the people picked. I feel like sometimes when I talk about what this job gave me, people are like, oh, it's just a job. Like, how did it give you that? And I want to tear up, like, just saying it. Like, this place changed my life. It really did. Like, and it just seems like a job to some people, and it just seems like a cafe to some people, and like, oh, what are they really doing? You know, it's just a job. Like, but it's so much more than that to me. It's not just one person or two people, it's multiple people that have gotten their fresh start from this place. And I know that this cafe is like magical. I really believe in what this cafe can do. I know what it did in my life and I've seen what it can do in other people's lives. And it's very special to me.
Every day is a new beginning. Mindy's story is even more evidence of how God is at work, So be a part of stories like it through your financial generosity. We invite you to give via the donate button or text or mail. Thank you for making God's love real.
In the dark and all alone, growing comfortable, are you too scared to move and walk out of this tomb? Buried underneath the lies that you believe, safe and sound, stuck in the ground, too lost to be found. You're just asleep, it is time to leave. Come on, arise up, take a breath, you're alive now. Can't you hear the voice of Jesus calling us out from the grave like Lazarus? Your brand new power of death couldn't hold you. Can't you hear the voice of Jesus calling us out of the grave like Lazarus?
Rise up,
oh, out from the grave like Lazarus.
When he said your name, the thing that filled your veins was more than blood's kind of love that washes sin away. Now the door is open wide and the stone's been rolled aside. The old is gone, the light has come. So come on and rise up, take a breath, you're alive now. Can't you hear the voice of Jesus calling us out from the grave like Lazarus? You're brand new, the power of death couldn't hold you. Can't you hear the voice of Jesus calling us out from the grave like Lazarus? Like Lazarus. Oh,
out from the grave like Lazarus.
He's calling us to walk out of the dark. He's giving us new resurrected heart. Oh, he's calling us to walk out of the dark. He's giving us new resurrected heart. Come on and rise up, take a breath, you're alive now. Can't you hear the voice of Jesus calling us out from the grave like Lazarus? You're brand new, the power of death couldn't hold you. Can't you hear the voice of Jesus calling us out from the grave like Lazarus?
Rise up,
he's calling you in.
Rise up, out from the grave like Lazarus.
You don't have to stay here.
Rise up,
he's calling us out from the grave like Lazarus.
For our benediction today, we invite you to lift your hands toward the screen as we hear this benediction based on this final story of Peter in John's Gospel. Now, let us go from this place to love, to feed, and to follow Jesus. Be more perfect in love day by day, and rejoice in the work of God in your life. In the name of God, our Creator, Redeemer, and Sustainer, and let all God's people say and type, Amen.
Thanks for joining us for worship. We want to encourage you to take your next step in your faith story, and we've created a landing page where you can do just that. You can learn about serving, small groups, or how to grow in your relationship with Jesus. You can find out more at the link below. If you're watching our broadcast at 9:30 a.m. or 11 a.m., you can join us right now in our post-service Zoom discussion group. The room is now open.
And I just wanted to say thank you again for loving me, supporting me, walking with me with these youth families. You have been a part of my journey, and I will forever be grateful. For the last time, Hyde Park, I'm Emily Felgenhauer, Director of Youth Ministries.
And I'm Matt Hotho.
Keep making God's love real.
Thank you.
Thank you.